Welcome to the Jack Westin MCAT podcast with your host, Phil Hawkins.
And Azaii Calderon Muñiz.
Fall is here. The leaves are falling. The air is getting a little crisp. Shortly, everything will be pumpkin spice flavored. And perhaps more importantly, for those of us who are wanting to become physicians, the AAMC makes their yearly announcements about what's going on with the next year's cycle of MCAT dates. So the AAMC just released an announcement about everything that's going on in 2022, and there are some changes. There's some changes from last year and the year before. It's kind of weird. Like, we're starting to transition to COVID being not as big of a concern, and I feel like that's being shown in the dates. I'm jumping in, so excited. Like, forget the small talk, right? there's some really important things happening. I don't know, Azaii, like, I know that you've been like pouring through it, overall, like the AAMC stuff. There's definitely a couple of things that surprised me in there.
Yeah. So there's definitely a lot going on. And for folks who, you know, have tested in the past and are retesting, or folks who have been paying attention to the previous cycles or considered testing in previous cycles and held off, you'll notice that there are quite a bit of changes in this new announcement, in this new release. And so our goal is to try and walk you through some of those so that you're really well prepared in order to actually test and actually register. And so registration is coming up. We still have a little bit to go, right? But in terms of the actual dates, so there are definitely some changes and not changes that I think you're particularly interested in.
Right. So one of the things that jumps out at me is that there are 30 test dates in 2022, which is actually the same number of test dates that they had in 2019, so pre-COVID. But the AAMC is still doing their spacing due to COVID. And so it's still going to be every other seat being taken in the testing center, which actually makes me like kind of nervous, because like, as I'm thinking about it, I'm like, okay, well, like the capacity of these rooms are being cut in half, but the actual number of dates is the same as it was pre-COVID. Now, I know that there are a couple of we've also for the most part gotten rid of like multiple test dates per day, which is what we've been doing for the last couple of years with COVID. In 2020, we had like three test dates or three like exam times in one day. So now we're going back to like pretty much pre-COVID levels of just like they're all at 8 a.m. There are a couple of exceptions. I think the 26th of August and then the 2nd of September and the 9th of September have like earlier and later ones. But for the most part, it's pretty normal, like going back to normal, where we have like a handful of dates in January, nothing in February, like two in March, and then like somewhere between three and four for most of the months, all the way leading up to September, where the last date is September 10th. I personally am wondering if they're going to have to add more dates. Because if they're cutting the capacity in half, like you have to somehow make up for this somehow. And so that's something I'm going to be like keeping my eyes peeled. And then once like, you know, March or June, somewhere in there kind of rolls around and the AAMC is like, we're adding new test dates. I'll be like, yes, I knew it. but I think that we could have situations where it's a little bit tricky to find seats. And so I think that this year, perhaps more than any of the previous years, being on top of registration might actually be critically important. So definitely want to pay attention to that.
Yeah. And as you know, as we kind of glance through things, I didn't see, and I don't, correct me if I'm wrong, I don't think you saw any changes to, or any announcements of changes of the number of sites, right? So, you know, without that information, like we really, like you said, we really don't know what the demand and the supply will be and what their match will be. And I think it's also really important that you pointed out that, you know, there are really only three dates that have multiple times, multiple start times in this cycle so far, at least as it's currently scheduled at the time of this recording, folks. So you start wondering, okay, well, in the past they had multiple times, right, for multiple days. Why might these dates in particular be, you know, have two options, you know, an early and an afternoon session? And then why this late in the year, right? So why the August and the September dates? And so just kind of, you know, we thought about this and we're thinking, okay, well, why would that be important or useful to have them towards the end? And, you know, we're not let's be very upfront about this, right? Very clear. I think no one thinks otherwise, but just in case, you know, we are not like official AAMC reps, anything like that, right? This is us having a conversation. We're just putting in, you're giving our input based on what we've seen over the last few years, what we're seeing and expecting this year. And then also just being aware that what we're saying here might have changed by the time you're watching this. If you're watching this 3-4 months from now, right? Like Phil is saying, it's very possible that some of that can change. But as of right now, you know, if you get COVID, right? If you test positive for COVID, you're not supposed to go in. I don't foresee that changing.
Right.
But as of now, you know, they have the ability for you to let them know if you can't attend, if you can't meet yours, or if you can't attend your session, your exam date because of a reason due to COVID. So they have that that emergency refund request in place. And so just kind of, you know, we're talking, we're thinking, okay, well, maybe these later dates that have multiple time options might be as a buffer for students, you know, if they have to reschedule because of COVID or something like that. But just keeping in mind that it is important to make sure that you do register as soon as you think you know when you want to test, because it will be a lot easier to have a test date and maybe need to reschedule than to not have a test date at all, right? That's a much more difficult position to find yourself in.
Right. Like an added layer to that though, is like, as we mentioned, like there's the emergency like cancellation and the MCAT will give you a refund. Cause I think they like are not sure how to get around this. Like, because if you have COVID, they don't want you to come in. And so they can't be like, don't come in. Also, we're keeping your money. Like that's hard for them to do like ethically. But they have reinstated the normal cancellation and reschedule fees that have been absent for the last couple of years. And so all of a sudden now you got to pay a lot more attention to like how close you are to your test. And so there's different windows. I think it's like 60 days, 30 days, and then 10 days before the test. And so if you cancel like more than 60 days before your test, you can get like a refund of $160. And so just some of the money you can get a refund. Now you can still reschedule and it's like a $50 just to reschedule it to a different time, as long as you can find a time that works. But, you know, different windows as time goes by, like after 30 days, like once you're within like 1 month of your test date, you can't get a refund under their normal policies unless you somehow get through the emergency cancellation stuff. I'm not sure how difficult that's going to be. They just announced this. So I don't know anybody who's gone through this process of knowing what that emergency cancellation process is going to be like. But the AAMC has reinstated this like cancellation and rescheduling fees that the students just haven't had to worry about for the last 2 years. And so now all of a sudden you need to start paying more attention. I think that forces students to be a little bit more aware of like, you know, even though my test is in January, let's say in November, I need to be really clear on where I'm going to go, because if I like wait 2 more days to reschedule, it's going to cost me an extra $50 on top of that, or it's going to cost me, you know, like once you're within 30 days, you can't cancel and get a refund. And so all of a sudden this starts, you have to kind of like be thinking ahead a whole lot more than needed to be the case. I know I definitely like advocated for students, in the last year of like, they're like trying to figure out when do I schedule my test? I'm like, just pick the closest date and then you can just reschedule it for free. And so if you need to push back, you can, and there's a lot more flexibility. There's no punishments for doing that because there was no cancellation fees, and rescheduling fees, but now they're back. And so that kind of doesn't work as well. Now I actually feel guilty. Like, am I the reason they're back? Because I've been telling students to just like, nah, just like pick a date and then you can move it if you need to. But these are things that you need to be aware of and are different from last year.
Yeah. And I think also with last year, right, there were so many more times. There were so many more times and you know, maybe the same amount of dates, but like there were more opportunities to test. And so I think this is also another way that they're kind of trying to balance that out, maybe, you know, by saying, okay, well, we don't have as many options, but now we're actually holding you to whatever date you choose.
Yeah.
And I think that is really important. Something that if you're like me, because I'm someone that can be very, very forgetful. If it is not on my schedule, it is not getting done.
Yeah.
I have, I don't know if I've actually shown you, Phil, but I have a spreadsheet with like every day what I have multiple things going on. So that way I can access it from my phone wherever.
Yeah.
But for some things, it's important to have like a reminder, right? Or have an alarm or like some kind of scheduling reminder. So if I were testing this cycle, what I would actually do is I would set a reminder for a week before a given deadline.
Yeah.
So I would set it a week before the 60-day deadline and say, okay, being very honest with myself, you know, what do I think this is looking like? Am I anywhere near where I'm interested in being? Am I totally off, you know, base? And then have another one similar, right, for the actual 60-day, and then something similar for the 30-day mark. Because like you said, if you reschedule or cancel within more than 60 days, you can get about half refund, right? And there's, like you said, that smaller cancellation fee. But then you get closer and there's a lot less wiggle room. It becomes a lot more expensive. And it's something to keep in mind. And then it's also important. And we're going to talk about the actual like registration in a moment, but just like thinking about these, I think it's important to talk about these fees. So all of the, like the numbers that Phil mentioned were if you don't have the fee assistance program that the AAMC offers. But something that's important, because I know a lot of folks are interested in like, okay, I'm antsy, like I want to actually register. If you think you qualify for the fee assistance program and you're planning on applying, make sure you do that before trying to register. Because if you register and then you're approved like that, they're not going to give you that money back. So this year, it's a little bit more important to pay attention to like the cost overall and those deadlines. Similarly, an additional kind of unspoken deadline is signing up for the fee assistance program and applying for it beforehand. So I think that if I'm not mistaken, the website mentioned it could take about like 10 days to get that processed. So I would imagine, okay, 10 business days before the registration date, I should for sure have filled out the fee assistance program application. That way I have an answer by the time I plan on registering. And then those fees, the actual fees that are associated with rescheduling and canceling will change for those folks compared to if you don't have the fee assistance program. So just something to keep in mind.
Yeah. Yeah. That's like the whole fee assistance and like accommodations kind of fits in there as well. That's a little bit different because it can be very difficult to get accommodations for some students. And I've had students that have had to apply 3 times to get accommodations. So that's something that if you think that you can get accommodations for the MCAT and you're hoping to do that, you want to like start that like months before your exam. Like if I was taking the exam in March, I should be working on the accommodation stuff right now to make sure that I can actually get those. Just a side note, like getting a letter from a school counselor or like a college counselor or something like that probably isn't going to hold a lot of water with the AAMC. If you can, getting a letter from a physician helps way more, like having like actual like physicians, you know, sign off on that, then that becomes a lot easier to get the accommodations. So just be aware of that if you're trying to get accommodations overall. But we should definitely talk about the actual registration dates since.
Yes. So there are two big registration dates coming up in October. So there's October 13th, which is a Wednesday, and October 14th, which is a Thursday. And these are going to open up registrations basically through the first half of the year. So, you know, registering for August, September, that's going to open up. That's going to open up a lot later. And I think if I'm not mistaken, it's like in February or so. But with this, they're actually dividing the country into two big groups. So there's going to be group A that's going to open up at noon Eastern time on October 13th. And then there's going to be group B, which is Western side of the US, October 14th at noon. And so essentially it's like Missouri, Ohio, Kentucky, Tennessee, Florida, East, right? That whole group is group A. And then group B is to the west of that. So those are the two big registration dates that you need to be aware of coming up for registration. And my mind is already on test day.
Yeah.
And there are actually a couple things that you can do ahead of time in preparation, and Phil will walk us through like the actual day of. But in preparation, there are a couple tabs, right? Registration tabs that you can complete before actually registering. And so making sure that you have those tabs completed. So going into your account, making sure you have an account set up. I would recommend one of those like saved password situations, just have it set up so you can easily log in. And you can fill out your name, your address, right? All of that basic contact information, making sure that it is accurate. That is incredibly important.
Don't misspell your name.
Do not misspell.
It will be a problem.
Yeah, but those are just some things you can do just working your way up to registration day.
Yeah. So just a little bit of context, just kind of stepping back. So registration day, you'll be able to like sign up for a certain day that you're taking the MCAT. And this has been a mess for the last couple of years. Especially like with the COVID stuff and rescheduling, I had a student that was like trying to register and like, they were like sitting there waiting and they were told like, okay, it's processing. And it was like 4 hours that they were like sitting there in front of this. And like, it was a weird scenario. Cause if you stepped away from the computer, like if it enabled you to register and then you didn't actually register in that 10-minute window, then it would kick you out. And so the student had to just like sit there in front of their computer for like 4 hours and like couldn't step away for 10 minutes. Otherwise they might just lose their line and they didn't know where they were at. And so this has been like a big mess. And obviously like we have already expressed that, like I personally think that there might be some shortages of seats for exams. And so this registration is going to be really important. You probably want to be on that first day if you can, if you know when you're going to take the test. But I think that's why they're splitting up the country into the two halves, is to like take some pressure off the system. And so like it should be half as many people on one day and half as many people on the other. And so hopefully that will help. But I still feel like there's a good chance it's going to be a little bit of a mess. And so if you can, you know, make sure that you can register as soon as possible. I've had students in the past that I've worked with that have had to like fly to other states in order to take exams because that was the only like time and place they could find an exam that worked for them. And that's not ideal. You don't want to be like flying to Arkansas for the first time and like, you know, not really jet lagged because I mean, it's not Thailand. But you know, sleeping in an unfamiliar bed and trying to navigate an unfamiliar city and all of this, like also the day of your test, like that's probably not ideal. So I think that this registration date is pretty important, especially if you're aiming for those earlier test dates, the January ones. I know there's a lot of students that are studying throughout the fall that are aiming for that January test date. So there's several of them that I'm working with like right now. And so another thing with this login is if you are in line, so it's kind of like a flip of like what it has been in the past. And I mentioned that scenario where people are like waiting for 4 hours to get in. In order to remove some pressure from the system, what the AAMC has done is that if you log in, like let's say I'm like trying to get a date, you log in, it puts you in line to, you know, to like go in and like, as soon as you filter into the system, you can pick your date and go on. But if you've been in line for more than 10 minutes, then you just end up like randomly placed in line. And so they're removing the impetus or the drive to like, all right, I'm going to like log in and then just sit here in front of the computer until it opens in 2 hours and I'll make sure I'm at the front. Like that's not going to work. And so what you want to do is like, once that it's noon Eastern time, I would just try to get in there maybe 5 minutes early or like 2 minutes early and like try to get in line there. But I'm getting the feeling that like things like, how's that going to work if it takes more than 10 minutes to like get to the point where you're registering for your date? Like, are they going to like kick you out of line for that? I'm not really sure. And so it'll be kind of interesting as well.
Yeah. And I'm really like, as you said, I'm really curious to see how that works this year, because the idea is that, you know, in the past, like you mentioned, people have gone in and opened their account early, right? So that they mm-hmm. can try and get a good spot in line. The idea here is that you want to get here 10 minutes early, right? Like that's the minimum, but any additional time earlier than that 10 minutes, it's just, they're kind of throwing you into a random spot in line. And so it's almost like a random lottery, right? So like the person who shows up 2 hours early is getting the same, you know, chance at the spot as a person who showed up an hour early, as a person who showed up 11 minutes early. Now, you know, the people who show up at noon, right, are getting the short end of the stick because now they're being tossed to the end of the line. And so that 10 minute mark is kind of the key. I would say I would set my, you'll notice that I'm an alarm person. Mm-hmm. I would set my alarm for 11 minutes before it starts and make sure that I am right there at that 11-minute mark, just so that I don't end up at the 9-minute end and then get put in the back of the line. But that's just, you know,
that's really clever, actually, to realize, you know, if there's 10,000 people that all sign in to the system before noon, like those 10,000 people, like, are just like, it's a random order within that 10,000, but like, they're all going to have to go through before the next people sign up. And so I was thinking, like, there's no reason to sign in before 10 minutes, but actually there kind of is. There's no reason to sign in 4 hours early, but there is, like, because you'll be in the same situation as somebody who signed up like 12 minutes early.
Yeah.
And so that's actually not a bad idea. But also, like, I also feel a little guilty about saying that, because that's, I feel like that's kind of gaming the system a little bit, but they're setting up the system this way. And it's such an important thing that I want to help students if I possibly can. But I wonder how this system will be able to handle it this year. Hopefully they've made some improvements, because I know it's been like just awful in the last couple of years.
Yeah. And this is where I think it's also important to kind of keep in mind as a student where you're logging in from, right? So if you know that the internet that you're planning on logging in from in general is a little slower and like pages take a little longer to load, right? You might want to give yourself that extra buffer time. So for example, if I were doing this on my campus Wi-Fi, I know I'd have to log in a little bit earlier. Whereas, you know, if I'm at home, then it's an Ethernet cable, right? It's fine. So it's like those little things that we don't think about, but that become important when registration day has been as historically mad as it has been. And so I think it's really great that you bring that up.
Especially just like, since it's on like Wednesday and Thursday, and a lot of times students are in class at those times. And so it kind of becomes difficult for a student. Like if you have like a 30-minute lunch break, like that may not be long enough for you to actually get through the system. It may be, maybe they've like fixed the system, so it works really great, but I'm not holding my breath for that.
Yeah. And something else that can help with some of that registration test day madness, because like you said, students have found it difficult sometimes, you know, especially in recent years, just to find a location that's good for the date that they want, a date that's good for what they're looking for. A little bit of context. So I don't think we've explicitly said this. Test dates are generally Thursdays, Fridays, and Saturdays. So they're weekends, and then you'll occasionally get a Thursday thrown in there every so often. So having a list of your preferred date and then backup dates, really helpful. Having an idea of what radius you're willing to travel is also important. So just kind of say, okay, I'm willing to go this far, that way in case I see that there's a test center that's a little bit further away, but I think I can make it on a day I want, I'm willing to make that, you know, I'm willing to negotiate that and make that concession. So having a couple of dates in mind, having a couple of locations, or at least a general radius that you're willing to travel in mind, will make registration a little bit easier, just because you don't know, like we've been talking about, where you'll be in that queue, in that line. So you don't know if you're going to get the opportunity for that prime spot, especially for folks who are, I think, on both ends of the extreme, where you're in an area where there aren't a lot of test centers, and so options are limited, but also when you're in a really rural, in a very urban area that has, you know, a lot of people testing in that area. So both ends of the extreme, your registration experience can vary quite a bit.
Right. That's like, it's also like, you know, we kind of mentioned that there's lots of dates and having an idea, like we could just like sit down and list all of those dates. Like there's 30 of them, but like, that's, I feel like that would not be a very good watcher / listener experience. So make sure to go to the AAMC, you know, check out their stuff. You know, like, as I said earlier, we're not the authority on this. We're just kind of like taking notes and like seeing, you know, trying to give advice based on this. There's a lot of information in there about like when the test dates are and when you'll get your scores back and what the like early and late, like cancellation, rescheduling fees, like what those are going to be and what those days are. There's also a lot of information in there about like masks, and like you have to use a mask unless you can somehow get a reason not to. But to be honest, you should be wearing a mask anyway, because it's just good and you want to be a physician. So hopefully you believe in viruses. You think they exist. But there are there's a lot of things going on there, and you want to kind of like go through with the checklist and like make sure that you have all your stuff for test day. And so we're not going to go into all of that. Because first off, it's kind of boring. Secondarily, like I think that, you know, things can change, and I don't want somebody to say like, well, Phil and Azaii said this, and so that's all I need to bring. Like, definitely check the AAMC's website, make sure that you have all the stuff going through there. look at their test dates, go off of those. I think, as I mentioned, I think there might be a scenario where the dates change a little bit this year. But we'll see on that. I'm actually really curious what's going on with those things. The other thing that I wanted to mention, you were talking about picking your dates and, having certain dates that you want to do. If you are testing with accommodations, most of the time your test will be split over 2 days. And those are always back to back. And so if there is a test date where there's just a random Thursday test and there's not a Friday or Saturday, that date won't work for you if you're doing accommodations. Note that only some dates work with accommodations. And so if you are testing with accommodations, check into that, because all of a sudden there's some test dates that you just can't use because they don't offer accommodations on those dates. And so if you are in that scenario, you need to be extra careful with picking your test dates.
Yeah. And if you're approved for accommodations, if I'm not mistaken, you can't actually reschedule from the website. You actually have to call. So it becomes a little bit more complicated. So I think what you're talking about being proactive with your test date selection is a really important point. It's, again, these little things that we're trying to help you folks with, just to make your registration day a little bit more doable and a little less overwhelming. But the really cool thing about choosing a day is that you can start building your timeline, right? Mm-hmm. You can start building your study timeline. And so maybe I'm a little too excited about this, but it's an opportunity to kind of really start diving into studying, building that timeline. Here at Jack Westin, we have some really cool new additions to the course and to the system. And so there's, for folks who aren't familiar with the course, so we have a lot of free material available. We also have a course that students can join us on. And so that paid course includes a study scheduler. And so we're actually going to have the ability to help you adjust your schedule as you're studying to your current needs. And so you'll be able to get an email letting you know what you should be working on that week. And if you're able to complete the material, then great, right? That mandatory homework. If for whatever reason you have a week that's a bit more difficult, then you'll be able, the scheduler will adjust. And so, you'll have that feedback, that scheduling feedback. So once you have a test date, it's really important to start thinking about prep in general and creating a timeline and considering what resources you want to use. And then if you join the Jack Westin course, you'll also have that scheduler that will help you maintain that timeline and that schedule that you're
in. And adjust as you get closer to your test date and as things pop up, which always happens. I feel whenever finals week hits, students all of a sudden are like, I didn't get anything done this week. And so I need to adjust my schedule, and those things kind of pop up. Speaking of just kind of scheduling overall, knowing your test date is really critical, because you need to be planning on how you're going to be studying. Most students study 3 to 4 months for their exam date. Also, though, most students wish they had a little bit more time. I've never had a student that studied for 3 months and is like, man, I don't need any more time. I feel perfect. Generally, they're like, man, I wish I had one more week. I would do this and that. And so thinking about this, most students do 3 to 4 months. I think aiming for more for 4 to 6 months is a little bit better if you have the option, if you have the opportunity for that. And so that's why it's important to know your test date. And so know when to start and how to tackle these things and in what order. And that's something that the course is really good at. But you kind of need to know your test date, because that should obviously be shaping and changing, how you are, prepping for the day of your test. I do want to mention, we also do have tutoring. That's something that is brand new here at Jack Westin. We have the best tutors, people that we have selected. We only have a handful of tutors. I know a lot of test prep companies have, 50 or 60 tutors, and they're just kind of going around, whatever. Our tutors are career tutors. They're not somebody who is just I took the MCAT last year and I need a job for the next month, or for the next 4 months or 6 months or whatever. And so our people, are career tutors, and they their their goal is to help students get to test A, and that's their biggest priority. And it can be very difficult working with some tutors because, you know, if they're in med school, then obviously med school has to be a priority, and, you know, trying to balance all that can be a little bit tricky. So note that that is something that we have just started doing, you know, offering that. Note that the opportunity is limited, or the supply is limited, because we want to make sure that we have the very best tutors we have. And so we can't handle 5,000 students all wanting tutors at the same time. So supply is limited there.
Yeah. And in addition to that, so we have, like Phil mentioned, there's this new tutoring, right? We also have a lot of resources in general. And so you may have noticed that, and I hope by now you've noticed that there are a lot of daily passages and questions that you can do. And so there will now be a QBank that allows you to sort through questions by topic, which is really exciting. That's a new addition here at Jack Westin, and a very powerful one, if you ask me, as you know, as you go through and as you figure out, you know, when you first start studying, what areas you're strong, you know, what areas are your strong points, what areas are your weak points, you're able to really tailor your practice, not just your content studying, which I think is incredibly powerful. And something that I was writing something up the other day, and I was thinking about weaknesses, right? And I say this now because we're, you know, I mentioned like topic weaknesses, and a weakness is really just a strength you haven't cultivated yet. Mm-hmm. And so I think that in addition to being able to study the material and the content, right, being able to apply it is really the key to the AAMC MCAT. And so being able to cultivate that area into a strength is a really powerful ability, and having resources that allow you to do that in addition to your own ability to personalize your review, I think is really important and very exciting.
Yeah, that's a big part of what happens in like the tutoring side of things, is I just spend my time working with students, helping to identify their weaknesses and then bringing them up to the point where that's not a weakness anymore. Like maybe I'm actually better at this now than I am the other stuff. And so my weakness is now my strongest point. I do want to kind of like just pause and clarify. So like the course and the tutoring stuff, obviously like that, costs money, but at Jack Westin, like we're really focused on helping students become physicians and like lowering the barrier to that. And so the QBank stuff, completely free. You guys know that we put out, like questions and passages literally every day we put out materials. And so, you know, our QBank is going to be growing over time because we're going to be folding this in. It took us a little bit. We had to build up a big enough bank that like this was actually possible. But now, like, let's say you just read some chapters and studied a bunch of stuff on fluid dynamics. Like now you kind of need to see some extra fluid practice, kind of focusing in on that. Something that I think most students are probably aware of at the moment is that, you know, one of the big resources for that in the past was Khan Academy, but Khan Academy has said they're disappearing at the end of this month, at least their MCAT stuff, not all of Khan Academy. we're trying to, you know, kind of bring in that resource for students. We are also going to be hosting all of the Khan Academy material. So Khan Academy has said that they're getting rid of their stuff because of the costs for upkeep and maintaining servers and like getting all of that going. And it's just been such a critical piece of so many students, especially students who maybe don't have the funds to pay for a like $6,000 Kaplan course or something like that. You know, people who don't have the funds for that. And so we are going to be hosting that. It's going to cost us money to do it, but like we think it's important for students to have. And so we will be, we have the vast majority of Khan Academy stuff. We will have the rest of it in our system by the time that the Khan Academy stuff stops appearing from Khan Academy. So we will be hosting that. And so that's not going to be disappearing forever. Ideally, we will hopefully be able to work that into the QBank stuff as well. And so you'll be able to filter by seeing like, is this like what kind, like, is this from Jack Westin? Is this from Khan Academy? You can kind of like figure out what sort of stuff you want to be seeing and from what sources. And so we will be we'll be hosting that as well, which I know a lot of students have been worried about. I've gotten so many questions about that. Oh, just over the last couple of months, like, what's going to happen with Khan Academy? Like, is there any way you guys can do? Like, yeah, we're doing it. Hang on. And so we will have that completely in the system. Is something we've been working on over the summer to make sure that we can maintain that resource for students.
For sure. And I think you said, I couldn't have said it better myself, right? We are interested in the development of all of you future doctors. And that's why we do this podcast. That's why we have, you know, these free resources and also additional resources that you can pay for to support the company, but also to get all these extra resources. And so, you know, today's podcast really was making sure that we get you guys up to date on the AAMC announcement. That was our priority, right? So, you know, super quick recap, making sure that you have your registry, all of the tabs, right? And the information that you can populate before registering, have that set up, making sure that you keep track of that time, the time on the day of registration, set an alarm, so have some way of making sure that you know when to start logging in, having a couple of options for when you're planning on registering, keeping in mind things like fee assistance program, keeping in mind things like accommodations, dates, and the definitely once you have your date, making sure you know all of the scheduling and cancellation dates and deadlines so that you have those, you're not caught off guard by them. And then once you have your date, considering resources that you're going to use to start studying, considering how much time you want to give yourself to study, like Phil said, err on the side of extra time rather than cutting it short, because you really don't know, you know, what we're still in the middle of a pandemic, right? So you want to make sure that you give yourself the time that you need for anything that might come up. Life does come up, can tell you that multiple times. Mm-hmm. And then just that last bit, updates on, you know, updates that we have here at Jack Westin that we're really excited to share with you guys. The scheduler, tutoring, the Q Bank, the hosting Khan Academy material. So really, we're just here to make sure that you have a smooth journey towards test day. And hopefully this most recent announcement can help you get on that journey, get that journey started. Thank you guys for stopping by.